that, preacher. Well, it's in the text, verse 1. He says, David says, blot out my transgressions. Verse 2, wash me from my iniquity. He says, verse 1, blot out my transgressions. Wash me from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. Wash me from iniquity. And in other words, what God's mercy does through the presence and power of Jesus Christ in our lives, it blots out our transgressions. What that means is a transgression is two words put together. The first word is trans. Trans means across or against. Gress means law. And so I have transgressed the law of God. I have done things to hurt other people against the laws of God. But through the mercy of God, he blots out what I have done to harm and to hurt other people. I'm the one in here. Ever hurt somebody? But he blots it out. He moves it. He removes it. But not only that, the Bible says he blots out our transgressions. He washes us from our iniquity. Iniquity is an inward thing. It's got the prefix IN, and it deals with the internal or the inward. And then iniquity, which is the second part of that word, is that which is crooked. So iniquity refers to that which is crooked in me. And so he washes, he straightens out, he corrects that which is crooked on the inside of me. So iniquity refers to those things that are in me that are wrong, because that's why I do wrong, because there's something wrong with me on the inside. And if you are honest, you will admit the same thing. Are y'all praying with me? He says he deals with my transgressions. He deals with my iniquity. But the Bible says he cleanses my sin. And my sin is that which is against God. And verse 4, David says, he said, I have sinned against God. I've sinned against thee and thee alone. Are y'all praying with me?
Yes,
sin is always against God. Even if you do it in the dark and you pull the shades down, God knows what you've done. And you have sinned against his purpose and his plan for your life. But I'm so glad that even when I do it, he gives me access to his mercy. Are y'all praying with me? And mercy reconciles me to God. But I can't take too long there. I got to deal with the other portions of this text. Verse 10 tells me not only is there reconciliation in God's mercy, but there is recreation. David goes to the heart of the matter. He says, create in me a clean heart. Are y'all praying with me? I said, because many of us are trying to change our habits and change the things we do without dealing with the reason why we do wrong in the first place. It is because of our hearts that we do wrong. And so David says, Lord, concentrate on my heart. Give me a new, I wish I had a witness in it. Give me a new heart, because it's out of my heart that I do things that are contrary to your will. And there's a lot of folks right now hesitating to commit to God and to accept Christ and to commit to a church because you're trying to handle your habits. But maybe you can't handle your habits if you don't deal with your heart. No sense in trying to mess with your movements if you ain't trying to deal with your mind. Then no sense in you trying to mess with your conduct if you first don't deal with your character. You got to give God your heart, your character. No sense in you trying to mess with your steps if you ain't getting your soul changed. You need a heart fixer and a mind regulator. His name is Jesus. Are y'all praying with me? Yeah, not only is there recreation, but mercy works because mercy brings about restoration. Restoration is associated with mercy. Verse 12, David says, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Don't miss this. Don't miss this, because David is saved. He knew he was saved. And he didn't say restore my salvation because I've done wrong. He said restore the joy of my salvation. Don't miss that. Because once you are saved, you can't lose your salvation. But sin in your life will cause you to lose your joy and your salvation. And so David says, restore my joy. I need some joy. And I love this. What I love about joy is joy is not happiness. Because happiness is based on what happened. Amen. But joy that goes beyond what's happening. All right, all right, all right. My numbers in the lottery didn't come up last night.
All right.
That's what happened. Y'all might well say, man, a lot of y'all play the lottery. I know you play it. And your number didn't come up either. That's what happened.
My Lord.
Because if your number would have came up, you'd have came in here shouting. Talking about what the Lord has done for me. But let me tell you, money can give you joy, baby. Yeah, because there's a lot of stuff coming with money.
All right.
You win $1 million, you're going to have friends and loved ones and family you didn't even know you had. And everybody's going to look at you like a big, fat dollar sign.
All right.
Oh, y'all don't get what I'm saying. And there are a lot of people who have hit the lottery who've been killed over their money. Y'all ain't hearing me here. I know you play the lottery, I ain't trying to bother you, but I want you to know that joy is not based on what's happening. Happiness is based on what's happening. And so if I got joy, if I got God's joy, it don't matter what's happening. It don't matter if I don't have any money. It don't matter if I didn't get that car I wanted. Testimony of what